multiply of 1 plus 0 instead of 1 as a little number less than 1 or a little number greater than 1. In short, if somebody is given an equation 1 plus 0, the only answer for that is 1. If anybody reduces that number or increases that number, in both the cases, the answer is wrong. Similarly, to believe any other scripture except the glorious Quran to be the 100% verbatim word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would also be wrong. But then, why do I not believe the Bible to be the God's word? I would request Pastor Ranjit Ophir to kindly help me in discussing this subject to my audience. I would like Pastor Ranjit Ophir to kindly pronounce a 7-lettered word to all the audience here. And the spelling of the word is B-A-S-T-A-R-D. To make it more clear, B for bush, A for always, S for Satan, T for terrorist, A for ambushed, R for rebuked, and D for dog. I request Pastor Ophir to kindly pronounce this word to my audience. Pastor Ophir.
Whether I agree with the full form of that so-called abbreviation, it can be pronounced as bastard.
And then I leave it to all my decent audience to believe or not to believe that can this word be used by the Almighty God? In our society, if any common man abuses another man without a genuine reason by calling this word, he can be booked under the Indian section 500. He'll be punished for it. But that word occurs in the Bible for no less than 3 different times. Not once, not twice, thrice it occurs in the Bible, believed to be the word of God. Or take it, it occurs in the Bible only 3 times. I'm asking, can the Almighty God speak this language? And if somebody says that the translators in English, they have mistranslated that word. Somebody, suppose they say that in the originals, I put the originals in inverted commas, in the original manuscript, this is not the correct word for it. So I would like to give the evidence from the Strong's reference dictionary, from Hebrew to English and Greek to English. The Hebrew word for the dirty, filthy English word is Mam Zare. And Mam Zare, if translated, would only be B-A-S-T-A-R-D. And in Greek, the word is Nothos. And Nothos, according to the Strong reference dictionary, if translated into English, it would only be B-A-S-T-A-R-D. In both the cases, the right translation is B-A-S-T-A-R-D. And this word occurs in the Bible, in the Old Testament twice, and in the New Testament one time. In the Old Testament, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 23, verse number 2, God says, "And the B-A-S-T-A-R-D shall not enter the temple of God, shall not enter the services of the God." It occurs again in the book of Zechariah, chapter number 9, verse number 6. And in the New Testament, in the Greek original manuscript, it occurs in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 12, verse number 8. These are the 3 different places where this word occurs. Therefore, I strongly believe that this word can never be used by the Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has to be by some historian or some other human being. But this word can never be the word of Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, the Bible is not the God's word. But then, what is the Bible? Bible is derived from the Greek word Biblos. And Biblos, it means a library of books or a collection of books. And this Bible is a collection of different books, basically categorized as the books of Old Testament and as the books of the New Testament. And then the Bibles are different. But as I have come to learn that Pastor Ophir follows a word of God of the Protestant Church that has only 66 books. Therefore, the topic of my debate would be more centralized on the Protestant Bible, whereas the Catholic Bible has 73 books. That is 7 books more than the Protestant Bible, which the Protestants do not believe to be the Word of God. The Old Testament is believed unanimously by both the Jews and the Christians to be a revelation from Almighty God. And the first 5 books of the Old Testament of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, are believed unanimously again by both the Jews and the Christians to have been written down by Moses, may peace be upon him, by Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, on the authority of the Almighty God, which again I disagree. The reason? The Bible does not stand as a proof to this claim. The Bible itself does not agree that Moses is the author of the first 5 books. Neither does the Bible agree that the Almighty God is the author of these books. How can I prove it? If you read the first 5 books of the Old Testament at random, open it anywhere, the first 5 books, and you will come across about 700 statements. About 700 statements that are an evidence that they are not a revelation from Almighty God, neither have they been written by Moses, may peace be upon him. For example, the statements are, and Moses said unto the God, and God said unto Moses, and Moses said unto the God said unto Moses. If God revealed it to Moses, the statement should be, I said unto Moses, and Moses said unto me. It cannot be, God said unto Moses, and Moses said unto the God. This statement does not occur once. At random, open any of the 5 books, you will come across more than 700 times that a third person is speaking there. And still if somebody, they say, no, this is not a genuine reason to disbelieve that the Old Testament or the first 5 books are not the revelation from Almighty God. So I will have to give another example. And this example is so simple that my eldest daughter, almost 8 years old, even she will easily understand that this is not a revelation from Almighty God. Now what is that example? The 5th book of the Old Testament, that is the book of Deuteronomy, ends on chapter number 34. When you open chapter number 34 and read verse number 5, 6, 7 and 8. Easy. This is not the book that I wrote it. This is not a book written by the Muslims. This is what sir believes to be the word of God. This is what the Christians believe to be the word of God. I want my Christian friends, if they have brought their Bibles, to kindly open the Bible and check the reference. Book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 34, verse number 5, 6, 7 and 8. Very easy reference to remember. How do you remember it? After 3, you get 4 as the number. 34, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. And the verses are, and Moses died in the land of Moab. Can you imagine? Moses is getting a revelation and Moses is writing that Moses died in the land of Moab. And he, that is the Almighty God, and he buried him in the valley in the land of Moab. And Moses was 120 years old when he died. How can Moses write this? How can Moses write and say that Moses died in the land of Moab, and he, that is God, buried him in the land of Moab, and that Moses was 120 years old when he died? Therefore, this cannot be the word of God. And if one statement is removed from the word of God, by God, it can never be the 100% verbatim word of God. Therefore, I believe that the Bible is not the God's word. Then, if you read the Bible, you will come across a history of a great prophet. We Muslims too revere that prophet. We call him Hud alayhi salam. Surah Hud of the glorious Quran is surah number 11. Hud alayhi salam, who is referred in the Bible in the Old Testament as Prophet Judah. And this Prophet Judah is also the father of the Jewish people. Judaism and the Jews, they got their name as Judaism and Jew from this prophet, Prophet Judah. He lived in a place by the name Judea. This is a very amazing story in the word of God. This story, I would like to put it not to the criteria of the Quran of judging which is the God's word, but to the very criteria of the Bible itself to judge how the God's word should be. If you read second book of Timothy, chapter number 3, verse number 16, verse number 1 and 6, it says, for any scripture to be breathed by the God, if God has breathed the scripture, meaning if it is the word of God, it shall be applicable for doctrine. It should have a good lesson in it, or a rebuke, meaning if you have done something wrong, immediately you should be punished for it. Third is correctness. You should be corrected if you have made an error. And the fourth is instruction to the righteousness. I would like to repeat the reference for Pastor Ophi to open it up. Second book of Timothy, chapter number 3, verse number 16. Four criterias. Now let us see the story that I am going to tell all of you now, whether it fits this standard of the Bible itself or not. Prophet Judah, and his story is mentioned in the book of Genesis, chapter number 38, verse number 1 to verse number 30. The story says, history says about this mighty prophet of God, Nauz Billah, may Allah forbid, that Judah had three sons by the name Er, Onan and Shelah. Judah married his eldest son to a woman by the name Tamar. And this fellow, Er, the eldest son of Judah, according to the Bible, was a wicked person. So when he went to consume the marriage, God slew him, as if God did not have any other time to slay him. At that very spot, he was about to consume the marriage, God slew him, and he was killed. Ask any Christian, sir, what is the lesson there? The lesson is from 2 Timothy. You see, rebuke. He was a wicked person, God slew him. Good. Then the story continues that according to the tradition, according to the custom there, Judah married his second son to his widowed daughter-in-law. Onan was married to the same woman, the same widow. And this Onan, he thought that if I beget a child, if DNA is done in that time and that child belongs to me, if he is my child, why should he be given the name of my deceased brother? He felt jealous. God became angry. God slew him. Ask any Christian, what is the lesson, sir? He would say, see, he was jealous. God gave him the punishment. He was slew. Very good. The story continues now. Judah tells to his daughter-in-law, Tamar, you see, Tamar, my third son is too young to get married to you. You return back to your father's home. When he grows up, I will call you back and I will get you married to my third son, Shelah. When the third son grew up, Judah thought as a father that even my third son will die if I marry this third son to Tamar, who looks to be of ill omen. So he cheats her. He forgets the promise. The prophet of God forgets the promise. He does not marry Tamar, but he marries his third son to some other woman. When Tamar comes to know about this, she said, I will surely take a revenge against my father-in-law. How does she take the revenge? So the Bible tells us, it's not what I say, it's not what the Muslims say, it's not what the Quran says, it's what your Bible says, sir. It says, Tamar, she played a harlot. What is a harlot? Harlot, according to the Oxford Dictionary, it means a prostitute. She plays a prostitute. And she says that when my father-in-law will pass to shear the sheep on this land, what I am going to do is, I will play a harlot and ask him to commit fornication with me. When Judah was passing Nauz Billah, prophet of God, he sees the daughter-in-law but does not recognize, according to the Bible, she was covering the face. So what he does is, he goes to her and he says, what should I give you to come in unto you? What should I pay you for that? So Tamar, the daughter-in-law, she says, a kid from the flock of the sheep. So he says, done. Agreement is over. I'll pay. But Tamar says, what is the trust? What is the guarantee that you'll pay me? So he asks, what guarantee do you want? She says, I want the ring, the staff, as a sign that you will not mistrust me. He gives it away, and the Bible says, it reports, Judah went in unto her, and she conceived. In the New International Version, the Bible translators have become bold now. They thought that the people are not understanding it properly. They say, he had sexual intercourse with her, and she conceived. Whom did she conceive? Faraz was a child whom she conceived. And this Faraz, why did I say all this story, do you know? This Faraz, in Gospel of Matthew, who is Faraz? Born out of illegal sexual intercourse between the father-in-law and the daughter-in-law. This Faraz is put in the New Testament in the first book of Matthew, Gospel according to Matthew, chapter number 1, verse number 3, to become the father of Jesus Christ, may peace be upon him, Nauz Billah. To a man, to a prophet who had no father, they gave a father in the Bible who is from an illegitimate progeny. Therefore, I say, this cannot be the God's word. God cannot speak all this. And he continues to ask our Christian friends, what is the lesson here? According to your Bible, it's not a doctrine. It's not a rebuke. Why is it not a rebuke? The verses do not continue after that. After she conceived, and the names of the children, God didn't say, I will slay you. God didn't say, Judah, I will kill you.